Hello, I'm Jen Moore, Program Annotator for Music of the Baroque. Welcome to Baroque Notes, our virtual pre-concert lecture series. Thank you for being here, virtually, as I discuss Vivaldi and Friends, the second concert in our 51st season. Guest conductor John Butt will make his first appearance with Music of the Baroque in these performances, which feature concertos by Vivaldi, Corelli, and Albinoni, as well as Bach's Orchestral Suite No. 1. You'll hear from him as well over the course of this talk, as he shares some of his own insights into the program. John Butt is quite an eminent figure in classical music, particularly Baroque music. He is a musical director of Scotland's acclaimed Dunedin Consort, which is currently celebrating its 25th anniversary. Under his direction, the ensemble has won 2 gramophone awards as well as a Grammy nomination. He is also Gardiner Professor of Music at the University of Glasgow, and he has written numerous books published by Cambridge University Press. We are so thrilled to have him join us for this program. The landscape of Baroque music was constantly in flux. New genres such as the concerto and cantata were germinating, while older art forms like opera continued to evolve. The popularity of instrumental music was surging, prompting new ways of composing, as well as rapid technical advances in instruments like the violin. Debates over concepts such as rules of composition, music theory, which country's music was superior, flourished heartily. Antonio Vivaldi was incredibly influential, but he still took artistic inspiration from others. Arcangelo Corelli, about 2 decades his senior, was at the forefront of the development of significant Baroque genres like the solo concerto, a work for solo instrument and orchestra, and the concerto grosso, grand concerto, a work for groups of instruments and orchestra. Born in 1653, Corelli was not only a composer, but was reportedly also an extraordinary violinist. After studying violin with master instructors in Bologna, he moved to Rome and in 1689 became first violinist and director of music to the newly appointed Cardinal Ottoboni, who regularly presented concerts in his lavish palace. Corelli ultimately became known as one of the greatest composers of his time, one of the first to earn such a reputation based solely on instrumental music. Despite his significance as a composer, relatively little of Corelli's music actually survives today. The only concerti grossi that exist, for example, are those contained in his Opus 6 collection, published in Amsterdam in 1714, 1 year after his death. John Butt describes Corelli's importance in the development of the concerto grosso.
Some scholars believe that the concerto concept was actually a dual concept, one based on the notion of competition between musical forces, and one based on the notion of harmony and agreement between musical forces. Whatever the nature of that competition or that dual nature of concertos, Corelli certainly falls on the side of cooperation and agreement. In fact, in some ways, I think he tries to keep alive the old late Renaissance view that pure harmony, pure music is actually an analogue of the stars and the heavens, the God-given layout of the universe, and that it therefore is a sort of heavenly sort of music brought down to earth. This is, I think, very clearly shown in the concerto that we play. It's almost as if there's continuous melody and continuous musical dialogue between the instruments. And it's almost as if Corelli doesn't want the music to stop. When you get to a cadence, he quite often repeats it as if he can't stop. And it's, I think it comes from the view that the world is a better place when music is sounding, and that it's always disappointing to have no music. So it's a continuous euphonous sound which keeps us enchanted in a world of music which in some respects is believed to resemble heaven, keeps us going for as long as possible within the context of each individual concerto.
The distinction between cooperation and competition between performing forces in the concerto is one of the distinguishing features between the works on this program. Let's listen to a little of the opening movement of Corelli's Concerto Grosso in F major, Opus 6, Number 6, you'll hear both the cooperation between the solo group and ensemble, as well as the repeated cadences or endings that John Butt mentioned. Are indelibly linked to Vivaldi's legendary status. His first vocation was a priest, and coupled with his red hair, led to the picturesque nickname the Red Priest. Lack of interest may have led to him abandoning that career, but it has also been said that terrible asthma made it impossible for him to officiate effectively at services. Also well known is Vivaldi's association with the Ospedale della Pietà, which began around 1704 and lasted for most of his life. Although the ospedale was usually called an orphanage, it was in reality a home for the illegitimate daughters of Venetian noblemen and was well financed by its anonymous benefactors. In addition to a place to live and an excellent education in music, the Pietà offered a creative outlet for women at a time when professional opportunities for female musicians were uncertain. The Pietà students were constantly in need of new music, and many of Vivaldi's compositions, including some 500 concertos, are composed for these talented performers. John Butt describes how Vivaldi's concerto writing differs from Corelli's and traces the path of its influence.
If Corelli represents the notion of concerto as agreement and euphony between different musical forces, Vivaldi, I think, is more of a sort of competitive type of concerto. In other words, he often has forces contrasting with one another, trying to outdo each other in some respects. And I think, although there are many of the sonorities of the music that you'll find both in Corelli and Vivaldi, they have the same sort of background in harmony, there's a real difference with Vivaldi in the sense that I think he's actually more down to earth. He's actually trying to show us actual events in human time, but also human characters, perhaps, and different characters of people, moods, and so on, often within quite a short space of time. So if we think of Corelli as a more sort of heaven-based composer in terms of the music he writes, Vivaldi is perhaps more earth-based. Ironic, actually, because he was actually ordained. He was a priest, as he's often said. One of the things that makes Vivaldi's concertos work on such a large number of occasions, there's so many of them, and they are actually much more varied than many people will believe. But one of the things that makes it work, I think, is the notion of the ritornello, Italian for little return. And what this means is that you get a whole collection of bits of music, which we hear together in sequence near the beginning, and they return as the piece goes on. There are lots of little returns, but they don't necessarily return in the same order or in exactly the same way. So this is something that gives the music a sort of logic. It gives it a sort of cohesion architecture, but it also makes it simultaneously surprising, because although many of the things we hear, we've heard before, we don't expect them to hear them always when we actually do. He's always sort of teasing us about what comes next and what happens with the music. So it's a certain sort of unpredictability to it, but also a sort of sense of overall architecture. And it's this style of writing concerto that he passed on directly to J.S. Bach, and J.S. Bach passed it on to his sons, Carl Philipp Emanuel, Johann Christian as well. And from there, it of course went to Mozart, who also uses a ritornello sort of style in his concerto. So really, this is the beginning of the genealogy of the modern solo concerto. Whatever the structure of the piece, one of the things you always notice, I think, in Vivaldi is a sort of sense of conversation. There's always a conversation. There's response, sometimes more aggressive, sometimes more euphonous, sometimes loving and sensual. You really feel that he's trying to cover all forms of human human meeting and human conversation.
Vivaldi wrote half of his existing concertos for the violin. Interestingly, the next largest group, 39 in total, were composed for the bassoon, an instrument that rarely served in a solo capacity. There are not many bassoon concertos from the Baroque era, or any other period of music, in fact, so this is truly a remarkable number, and we don't know why he wrote them. There's actually no record of a bassoon teacher at the Pietà, nor records of purchases of instruments or reeds, but contemporary accounts suggest that the students tackled every available instrument. As one 18th century writer observed, they play the violin, the recorder, the organ, the oboe, the cello, the bassoon. In fact, there is no instrument large enough to frighten them. In any case, the concerto's high degree of difficulty indicates they were written for performers of unusual prowess. Let's listen to the opening allegro from Vivaldi's Bassoon Concerto in C major, RV 472, which will be performed by Music of the Baroque principal bassoon William Buckman. Enjoys far more posthumous fame than the other. Tomaso Albinoni and Antonio Vivaldi had a great deal in common. Both were born in Venice about 7 years apart. Both were violinists and were praised for their achievements in the new genre of the concerto. And both began their musical careers in other professions. Albinoni's father, a maker of playing cards, received a paper mill from his former employer. Although Albinoni actively performed and composed music, he did complete an apprenticeship in the family business. It was soon clear that his passions did not lie with paper, however, and upon his father's death, he shed his amateur guise and became a professional musician.
Albinoni, who also wrote in the Vivaldian style, is an interesting figure within the context of this program because I think he also absorbed quite a lot of the Corelli style. In other words, he keeps this notion of endless melody but combines it with the ritornello style. So there is a real sort of sense of the two styles coming together in Albinoni. And particularly if you think of the middle movement of the oboe concerto, you also get the sense of aria, of song, with orchestra accompanying the voice, in this case the oboe, in impersonating a voice. And this is another element of concerto style that is there quite early on in the 18th century, the notion that it can also imitate actual human voices. So Albinoni then, a very interesting combination then of the sonorities of Vivaldi and of Corelli. Thank you.
Well, today we can order music from anywhere in the world and download original manuscripts for free. It was much harder for Baroque composers to access others' music, of course. The advent of published music was a major advancement in this sense. If Corelli's Opus 6 collection had not been published, it would not have had nearly the same influence. We might not even know it today. And published music was how Johann Sebastian Bach came to know the music of Vivaldi. Between 1711 and 1713, during his tenure at Weimar, Johann Sebastian Bach traveled to the Netherlands, then the center of music publishing, and brought a great deal of music back for the Weimar Court Orchestra. Among the scores he transported was Vivaldi's Opus 3 collection, L'Estro Armonico. This choice was due in part to the taste of Prince Johann Ernst, who reportedly adored Italian concertos and required Bach to perform transcriptions of them on the keyboard. This exercise profoundly affected Bach. As his biographer Forkel wrote, Bach felt there must be order, connection, and proportion in the thoughts, and that to obtain such objects, some kind of guide was necessary. Vivaldi's concertos for the violin, which were then just published, served him as such a guide. He studied the chain of their ideas, their relation to each other, the variations of the modulations, and many other particulars. The change necessary to be made in the ideas and passages composed for the violin, but not suitable to the clavier, taught him to think musically. The musical structure of his concertos centers on stark contrast between solo and ensemble, harmonic stability and movement, fast and slow tempos, and more. Rather than blindly imitating Vivaldi, however, Bach internalizes these principles and makes them his own. While the Orchestral Suite No. 1 is not a concerto, these principles are still active in the music.
In a sense, Johann Sebastian Bach is the odd one out in this program because we're not actually playing a concerto by Bach, but a suite, which is a sort of paired genre, a genre that sort of is often paired with the concerto. There are elements of the concerto, though, particularly in the first movement, in the big overture and the wonderful fugue between the woodwind team and the strings, which does bring in many of the structural and rhetorical devices that one finds in Vivaldi's ritornello form. But the rest of the piece, I think, represents perhaps the elephant in the Italian room, which is, of course, the French style, because the French went out of their way to do something that wasn't Italian. Their whole style of writing the music, although in many respects very similar, they went out of their way to try and make the shape of the music different. And they were particularly good at dance music, and that's exactly what this suite is. It's a suite of French style dances. Again, each one brings a character, just in the same way that Vivaldi's Ritornelli brings several different characters together. And you could really feel the sort of movement of the body expressed through the shape of the phrases in the wonderful dances. Having said that this is different from the other pieces, of course, there are also dances in the Italian part of the programme. The first Corelli piece we play ends with a dance, a sort of gavotte style, gavotta, which is, you can hear the French version in Bach's rendering of it and the Italian version in Corelli's. And the A major concerto grosso by Vivaldi ends with what is rather like a bourrée, French bourrée or a boria in Italian. So there are Italian dances as well as French dances. So you can actually hear that dance also belongs to concerto, as well as concerto belonging to dance, to the dance suite. And I suppose in a sense then, although Bach is the odd one out in a way, here he's actually the summary of all the things we've heard, the euphony of Corelli, the structural excitement of Vivaldi and the sort of earthbound conversations, but also that style that the Italians don't mention, France. Thank you.
One thing the past year has underscored is that at times, as the Beatles famously sang, you need a little help from your friends. Corelli, Vivaldi, Albinoni, and Bach may not have been friends per se, but they definitely influenced one another. I am grateful to John Butt for his help with this edition of Baroque Notes, and I hope this talk has given you a little help, a few things to think about as you join us for Vivaldi and Friends on Sunday, October 17th, 7:30 p.m. at the North Shore Center in Skokie, Monday, October 18th, 7:30 p.m. at the Harris Theater for Music and Dance in Chicago, and on demand at baroque.org through November 25th. Thank you so much.